is the digital workforce? I just asked it and no one put up their hands. So, I was about to make a speech on the digital workforce. I have a website about the digital workforce. And I thought, what is it? I have no idea what the digital workforce is. If I had to give a scientific definition, I wouldn't know. So, I started looking online. And there's nothing in the scientific libraries. The concept is way too new for science to catch up. Then I started looking on Google and I couldn't really find any definition of the digital workforce. Basically, no one knows what the digital workforce is. We do, however, know that the digital workforce is very important. This is a Deloitte study, 2017. Digital HR is there on top. The percentage of respondents rating the trends important or very important. So everyone says it's very important. We have no clue what it is. So I thought it would be good to first take a look at what the digital workforce actually is before we start talking about how we can leverage it and how we can use it in order to make better business, better revenue, and in order to reach business goals. So it has something to do with mobile, with technology. When I look at the articles that are written about it, the term revolutionize occurs quite often. And it's about digital platforms and apps. But still, what is the digital workforce? We still don't know. So, I was trying to figure out how am I going to define what the digital workforce is, because I need to give a keynote in 2 weeks, and I still have no idea. And then I remembered a book that was written about, I think, 3 years ago, 2014. And I hope some of you have read the book. And if you haven't read the book yet, read the book. Because if you're interested and excited about digital HR, you really need to read the book. And I know a lot of HR people are readers, so check this book. The book is called Exponential Organizations by Ismail, and Yuri van Geest is one of the co-authors, who's a Dutch guy, just like myself. Who has read this book? No one. Read it. In that case, I'll explain what the book is about. The subtitle says, why new organizations are 10 times better, faster, and cheaper than yours. And this fits into the trend that a lot of Fortune 500 companies are starting to disappear at a faster and faster rate, and they're being taken over by Google, by Facebook, by Instagram, by Snapchat, by, you mentioned them, the really, really fast-growing companies. Those companies, they start as startups and then become scale-ups, they start to grow really, really rapidly. Those companies do something very good that the traditional companies don't do that well. And this book basically describes what makes these companies different. First of all, these companies scale processes and people. So if you're a startup, before you can really start to scale up, when you have 100 people added to your platform every day, or 1,000, or maybe 10,000 people added to your platform every day, you need to be very, very efficient in processing all those requests. So before you really start to scale up, you need to be very, very efficient. So you need to make all your processes highly efficient, and also your people highly efficient. One person needs to, if you look at the revenue per employee, and that's highest for Google, for Apple. Why? Because they've made all the processes highly, highly efficient. Second, an exponential organization, so an organization that can grow really, really fast, should be flexible, work with real-time data, have low cost, limited hassle and risk. And I think a good example to illustrate this is Richard Branson when he started with Virgin Airlines. Richard Branson, I think he got famous with his Virgin Airlines brand, but he was already working on his Virgin Record label and he had a number of different businesses. And when he started, he got the idea of, hey, I'm going to start an airline that's actually fun and that people enjoy flying with. He gave a call to Boeing and he said, hello, this is Richard Branson speaking. I'd like to lease a Boeing 737. The guy at Boeing said, lease a plane? Like, are you kidding me? He said, no, I want to lease a plane. I don't want to buy a plane, I want to lease the plane. And why does leasing make sense? Well, first of all, it's a smart business decision. You don't need the upfront money in order to buy a plane. But second, if Virgin Airlines would have failed, after 1 or 2 years, he would have had to sell the plane. If it failed, he wouldn't be stuck with a massive aircraft that would cost him millions and millions of US dollars. So he wanted to lease the plane in order to limit the risk, in order to keep the cost low, and in order to be very flexible with his business. Anyway, the previous speaker
by the way, had a slide on the exponential lowering cost of products that were developed. So doing a DNA genome scan went from, I don't know how many, thousands of dollars to, I think, only 10 or 20 bucks now. Same with drones, they became really, really cheap. That same trend, you're seeing that same trend in organizations. When we talk about the digital workforce, we know that the digital workforce is related to companies that can scale really quickly. And if I continue in this book, I get towards five key characteristics of the digital workforce. And I think that's why the book is really, really interesting. It says every organization should have a massive transformative purpose, like a nice or fancy word for having a vision, having a mission. That's some people are really wild about. You have ideas and you have skill. And what I want to focus on is the skill criteria. Because if you want to have an organization that can grow really, really fast, you need a workforce and you need digital capabilities for your workforce that can actually enable you to grow really, really, really fast. And the five criteria are skill, staff on demand, communities and crowds, the A is for algorithms, leveraging assets, and in the end, engagement. Engagement, I think, is a celebrated word here. We all love an engaged workforce. And I'll explain you why engagement becomes more and more and more important. The first criteria is staff on demand. And Barry already told about that when he talked about his, you had a really nice word for it, the inner core and then the flexible, reliable people that are around that inner core. So you have a core team that is really key to the business, and you have a flexible layer around that. How does that play out? An example is Gigwalk. Gigwalk is an application that gives you access to 1.2 million people. Imagine you're a production company that's producing biscuits. And you're producing biscuits and you're selling it in shops all over Greece. Now, how do you check if those biscuits are really displayed like you agreed with your supermarket? Like top shelf, because you're an A brand and you really want to make sure that all the labels are right and the display is really, you have three rows instead of the two rows of your competition, etc. How do you check those kind of things? Well, you can send an employee to check 10 supermarkets a day, and then the next day 10 other supermarkets, make pictures of it, and do it that way. But that would cost a lot of money. Now, Gigwalk enables you to, in the morning, say, hey, I want a picture of this product in this supermarket, and by the evening, one of the 1.2 million people that use Gigwalk went to the supermarket, they get a ping on their phone, they make a picture, and you have it. It's instant, almost real-time, almost instant data. This is very scalable. This enables you to work with real-time dashboards, to work with real-time information about products without really having staff in your own whole workforce. So you can focus on the people that build the business, and you have an external group of people that can help you do certain tasks. Who knows Fiverr? I see 4, 5, 6, 7 hands. Fiverr is, I think, especially interesting for small and medium-sized companies. Fiverr is traditionally started out as a service where you could, for $5, ask someone to do any job, or ask anyone to do any job. When you need to make a design, you can put, say, hey, I would like to have a design with these criteria, and different people can say, okay, I would like to make it, give me the $5, and I'll make that design. Now, when our designer, the designer in my company, if he needs to make a design, he first goes to Fiverr and he sets out a job. And he lets 10 people take the job and 10 people send in a design. He then takes all 10 designs and he says, I like that one the best. But from this other design, I like this small detail. And from this other design, I like yet another detail. He then throws it together and he basically has a remote brainstorm with 10 very different people, 10 very different perspectives, and he doesn't have to spend a lot of time on getting stuck in one picture and not letting go and then falling in love with your own product and then not really ending up with a beautiful product. So whenever our designer needs to make a product, he goes to Fiverr, gets the ideas, and then builds a better design for a logo or whatever he's trying to design. So those are ways to leverage people that are outside of your organization people that are oftentimes curated, so you know that they will deliver quality. And there are ways to get towards those, to get to those people and to leverage the staff on demand. So that's the S in scale. The C stands for communities and crowds. And communities and crowds are a bit fringe to HR. HR is not really used to managing communities. But there's one really, really big platform that relies for 100% on a huge community. Who has any idea which platform that might be? Facebook. Facebook does that for a big part. Like, all the content on Facebook is produced by the users. So the users come back because they want to check out the content of other users. So that's a brilliant example. I went to Wikipedia, which is basically identical. Wikipedia has more objective information compared to Facebook. And on Facebook, we show our best sales, of course. Wikipedia has around, I think, 120,000 Wikipedians who are active contributors to the website. And every single day, thousands of articles are added, and way more articles are changed, and small adaptions on those articles are made, with a big crowd, which, in a sense, are the human resources, the remote human resources, for, in this case, Wikipedia. So how do you manage this crowd? That's something interesting to keep in mind when we go forward. So we're at scale, that's CSA, A for algorithms. Algorithms is something that we've talked about a lot already. Algorithms make life easier. How do they do this? I think we've already had a few examples. I just missed my slide. There's yet another example, but I'll skip one. Algorithms help you do certain jobs better. So, for example, when I write quite a lot of articles, when I write an article, I put it through two programs. First one is Hemingway, it's here on top. Hemingway is an editor that points out all the sentences that are difficult. So as you can see over here, instead of relying on gut feeling, the head of human resources, HR, decided to crunch the numbers to see how effective the interview process really was and how it could be improved. That's a complicated sentence. Now, that gets flagged. So I know that I should say, hey, instead of relying on gut feelings, the head of human resource decides to do other, to do it in another way, period. And then I start my second sentence, and I break a really long sentence into multiple smaller parts. And immediately the text becomes easier to read. And when people come across a blog, they want an easy to read, an easily digestible text. It also points out a passive voice, so can be made, and to make is more active, is nicer to read than can be made. It points out simpler alternatives, adverbs, etc. It helped me to write a better text. A second app is Grammarly. Grammarly helped me to fix problems in grammar. I'm not a native speaker, so when I write, I make quite a few mistakes. This prevents me of having to hire a proofreader who is reading all my work. And of course, it's not yet perfect, but it's starting to get there. A second example is FeeBelly. Who has ever signed a contract? I'll repeat, who ever signed a contract? That should be all hands. All hands in the air? Who signed the contract? Everyone. Somebody even signed two contracts. When you sign a contract, you're always a bit aware and a bit scared of those little letters that you just skipped over and you didn't check out, right? That's my big fear whenever I sign a contract. FeeBelly is an app that scans the contract and that says, like, hey, you should pay attention to these specific clauses. So that helps me to identify all the nasty things in my contracts so I don't miss hidden costly details. FeeBelly can be used by me, so I don't have to go to a lawyer and check everything. But FeeBelly can also be used by the lawyer himself, just as a final check in case he didn't miss anything. FeeBelly makes my life easier, I don't have to pay the lawyer, and it makes the lawyer's life easier because he can do his work faster. He might have less work, but that's a whole other discussion. Anyway, this is a way that algorithms are starting to make work more efficient, very much like Jake was using algorithms, in a sense, rule-based algorithms to automate his own work. And when we talk about algorithms, we can talk about making things more efficient. We can also talk about full automation, which is, of course, way more efficient. Can you leverage technologies to basically replace traditional functions? And we just talked about writing articles. Each and every one of you reads the news. So most likely, you've read multiple articles that are written by non-humans. Given the right keywords, computers can produce a perfectly fine article. And that's not necessarily bad. When I go to Reddit, a social media platform, and I see an article, I go to the comment section, and there's always a bot that summarizes the article for me. It says there's only 5% of the length of the original article, and the summaries are always spot on. I don't know how they do it, but they're always spot on. So I don't need to read the full article anymore. I can just check out the summary and be more efficient. It's just one of those ways how traditional jobs are starting to get replaced. This is a study by The Economist 2014 of, I think it's multiple studies have been done on this topic, like what jobs are getting replaced. I think The Economist one is one of the best. On number one, there's telemarketers. There's loan officers up there, there's tax administrators. All the jobs that fit in a nice matrix box, so to say, that are quite one-directional, are at risk of being replaced. In the booth, and some of you, I think, are listening to me in Greek, there's a translator. I think Google, a few weeks ago, came in the news of publishing a clip that would record the voice coming into your mobile phone and then record immediately translated to a different language. Like this is what they used in Star Trek, the communicator, or I think it was called, before my time. Anyway, the communicator, that's actually starting to become a reality. So that's maybe also a job that's starting to disappear. So then it starts to become really, really close at home. And as HR, you need to pay attention. So we're still looking at what the exponential organizations are doing right. Skill, we're at the L of leveraging assets. The last one is the E of engagement. Now, when you have a small core team that's really contributing the core value to your organization, you really need to engage that workforce. And you can engage multiple ways. You can use gamification. I think Jive was just mentioned in a previous presentation. This is, I think, a nice way of gamification your recruitment process. It's basically a recruitment board for Google saying, hey, the first 10 digit prime found in consecutive digits of e.com. So those 10 numbers, .com, then you end up on a website and it says, congratulations, you've passed the first step, and then you get a second very difficult mathematical problem that I don't understand at all, but I thought it just looked good. Another one is CNAC, or NAC, depending on how you want to pronounce it. That's really doing the traditional predictive recruitment tool, but then in a game. Air traffic control, when you want to apply to become an air traffic controller, traditionally you already had to play all kinds of memory games where they would select you. This is coming to normal everyday jobs where you play a game and the performance on the game is actually predictive of what you're doing. Anyway, this is probably not new for you, but it is a reality that's coming closer and closer. So the five key characteristics of the digital workforce, and now we're coming towards a definition of the digital workforce, are skill, algorithms to make work more efficient, leveraging algorithms, leveraging software and technology to fully automate work, and in the end, engage the workforce. Skill. So skill, I think, offers a framework to put everything that we're talking about today more into a business perspective. What do we want to achieve with the business? What are the business outcomes that we are going for? And then how do we place it into perspective